Hey Potters, Amber here. I did ask a few of you guys if you wanted to see the process of me making my Legolas daggers. And that's these guys. And this is for my my LARP character, my very first original character that I'm going to make. And I wanted her to have the dual-wielding daggers, which, oddly enough, these are 24 inches long, so they're not exactly daggers. They're more of short swords. Oddly enough, the blades are 16 inches by themselves, which is longer than most daggers. But I wanted to dual-wield because I thought it was awesome, and dual-wielding is, in fact, awesome. And so the very first thing I did, and I'll explain a little of this while I'm waiting for the hot glue gun to heat up, because that's actually the next thing I'm working with. The very first thing I did, which you can't see all of this, but I'm holding up a 48-inch long strip of poplar wood. And that's this guy, you know, you can see all the way down. There's the end of the wood. So I took this 48-inch long piece of poplar that I bought at Home Depot. It's 1/4-inch thick. This is what they call hobby-sized. And the very first thing I did, after patterning out my knife, and this is actually the pattern right here and right here, I've had to actually cut it apart. And I'll explain that part later. But originally I had it together like this. And so I took that, and then I traced it on the wood. I'll lift it up, that way you can see it. So basically I laid the pattern down and I traced it on the wood. Once I did that, I'm going to set the wood down for just a moment. There we go. Once that was done, I made friends with my scroll saw. I had to make very, very good friends with my scroll saw, because unfortunately, for those who have never used a scroll saw, this particular scroll saw here is actually not meant to cut hardwood. Poplar is not terrifyingly hard in terms of wood, but, and no dirty jokes here, guys, but it did not take very well to the poplar with the blade that it came with. This is the blade that it came with. You can see it has a whole bunch of teeth. However, they are very small teeth. That means this blade is not very strong. It's not coarse enough to be able to cut through wood. This particular blade is meant mostly for balsa and foam, I found out. It cuts fantastically through EvaFoam, incidentally, so you can always use the default blade with the EvaFoam, which you can see my giant pile there in the corner. So what I ended up having to do, and I'm not necessarily endorsing these, I'm simply saying this is what I used and this is what worked. I used a set of Ryobi blades, and these are actually rated for wood and plastic, as the package says. They are pinned blades, because this particular scroll saw takes pinned blades. And this is a pack of, I think, four? Yep, it's a pack of four blades. So now it has three. But I went ahead and installed that blade on the scroll saw instead, and I bought those at Home Depot. And that seemed to work well. And then basically I cut it out very carefully, and I'm really sorry to my neighbors for having to do this twice, because it did actually sound much like a dying cat as I was doing this. And you'll notice that I've wrapped the handles in fabric. That's simply because the edges are unfinished. This wood had a lot of splinters, and it still does. You can actually, you may be able to see it with the shadows, but there's a lot of splinters down this wood. So I didn't want to hurt myself as I was holding on to it while I was cutting the blade portion. So I did that with both handles. That way, you know, safety first. So I cut out the shapes for both after sketching it out. Which, if you ever need Lord of the Rings references, incidentally, or if you need elvish type references, go to a website called Alley Cat Scratch, and that is all one phrase. There are no spaces or dots in between them. It's AlleyCatScratch. Alley Cat Scratch. Because they do probably the best breakdown of all of the Lord of the Rings costumes I have ever seen, including high-res close-up shots of the actual museum pieces from the roadshow, which is where I actually found the reference shots for these guys. So, once I had cut these out, then I had to figure out how to do the decor, because if you've ever seen Legolas daggers, they have all this really elaborate engraving on them, which, unfortunately, my hand isn't steady enough with a Dremel to do. So, what I did instead, let me put my pattern pieces over here to the side so I don't lose them, because I am going to need them.
Here's my pattern piece.
I cut out a miniature pattern piece with the filigree part on it. You can see it actually ends right there in the loop. But I free-handed the filigree part. Sorry. And then once I did that, this is made out of poster board, by the way, nice and floppy.
Then I took it
and I did a shadow box technique. I put the poster board behind printer paper, and then I traced over the lines again, and then I went over the lines a third time with a Sharpie, and that was so that I could make them consistently thicker. You can see they've actually got substance to them. And the reason I did that is so that I could cut them out of paper. Like this. And let me tell you that this took a really long time, and my fingers really did not like me afterward. I had to cut these out mostly with manicure scissors, simply because, again, I'm not consistent enough with, you know, small tools like X-Acto knives to be able to do that. But I have very, very good control with manicure scissors. So I went ahead and I cut this out. And then I duplicated that 4 times, one for each side of the blade, front and back, front and back. So I basically took the general shape. I took that and I cut it out of styrene. And then I cut the filigree part out of paper, so it kind of has a 3D overlay effect. So I'm going to take the styrene portion, which is the underside, going to paint that one gold, since that's the way it is in the movie. And then the filigree part, the paper part, I will have to paint silver. I'm going to glue the paper part down to the styrene, and then I will glue the styrene to the blades. So that once done, see, I think this one, yep, this one. Oops, this side, like that. So it will basically end up looking something like that, except this will be stuck down. I'm trying not to push too hard because, again, the blade has splinters all over it. So it should look like that. So the handles were the next part. I cut those out of Evafoam. These were out of scraps from my Athena corset, since you guys have seen me working on my Athena corset. So I basically just cut them to shape to the handles. These are pretty thick. These are thicker than I want, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to hot glue one on each side. Except that's the wrong piece, I think. Yep. It goes like that. So I'm going to sandwich this together with high temp hot glue, which is what I'm waiting on heating. And then where you see the square markings here, I'm going to carve divots so that this section in the middle is rounded for my hand to grab, but the rest of it will be shaped. And I'm going to try and do that with a Dremel. Unfortunately, sculpting is really not my forte, and I admit that. You know, for as much as I've done in cosplay, I'm not perfect, and I never will be. And I'm cool with that. But I've also learned to recognize my limits, what I'm good at and what I'm not good at. And sculpting, in general, is something that I am not good at. So this may be something that I fail entirely at, and that's just part of the learning process. So, you know, as this recording goes on, you may actually see me completely screwing these up. And if I do, well, there's more Evafoam and hot glue and more Dremeling, which I have 4 drums left. My sanding drums, so that's all I get. So we'll see how that goes. Looks like the hot glue gun has warmed up, so I'm going to turn my camera back around here. There we go. That way you can see what I'm doing. I need to unwrap the handles because I can't glue the foam over this. Because satin ribbon does not have very much tensile strength where it comes to hot glue. And this was just scrap ribbon that I had lying around my apartment. I could have probably done it with masking tape, but then I would have had a lot harder time taking all of this off. And to be honest, I'm fairly lazy, actually, most of the time. It may not seem like it, but I'm actually a fairly lazy person most of the time when it comes to doing things the right way. So now you can see how the raw handle looks. Like that. And these do make a nice whoosh when you swing them. I admit to having played with them. Unfortunately, I smacked my table with one of them as I was playing with them, because I don't play very well with knives. But thankfully, I took that as my test to make sure that these were suitable for costume use because it did not break or crack. Which was a very, very good thing. Alright. And I can tell which end goes on which, by the way, because one of these sides is rounded slightly, as opposed to being completely flat, which is the back. The back is completely flat. So I know, for example, that this one goes on this side. And these are pretty closely cut to the exact same shape, since I cut them out of the same pattern as the original wood pieces. And I cut these on the scroll saw as well. Which, incidentally, Alan, if you are watching this, I noticed that changing out the blades to the Ryobi blade, I don't know if you can see it here, the contrast isn't as good, but both ends are finished equally well this time. I didn't have the weird, you know, left side, right side, one side being finished more than the other. There is slight abrasion on one side, but it's far, far cleaner than the other, so I'm wondering if it's simply due to the nature of the blade itself. I've noticed that the default blade has a lot smaller teeth, and there are more of them than the Ryobi blade. The Ryobi blade is a lot more coarse, so I'm kind of curious. Alright, so I've got my high temp hot glue gun. So I'm going to liberally spread glue across the handle, put this down, and then hold. It should not take very long because this is high temp glue. And you're going to notice that I do this in parts. I don't do the whole handle at once, and there's a reason for that. And it's mostly because high temp hot glue, for as much as it's ballyhooed for, you know, giving you a bit of working time, I have found really doesn't. Unfortunately, high temp hot glue is an animal of its own, and more or less, once you position something using high temp hot glue, once you push down, even with any amount of force, that's it. That's all you get. It's very, very difficult to pull them apart, simply because the high temp glue will weld them together. It will actually start to meld the two materials that you're pushing together into each other. Just like, since this is wood, wood is porous, so the high temp hot glue is already sinking into the pores of the wood. And it's also sinking into the pores of the foam. So when I push them together and then I try and tear them apart, then I start tearing at the material itself. So that is why you will find that I tend to do the high temp hot glue, and sorry that my big head is in the way. I tend to do these in parts. There we go. And I'm making sure to push down so that the surfaces are flush. You'll notice that a lot of my scraps actually have bend to them. And that was not intentional. Foam does not start out this way. It is because those were from scraps of my Athena corset, which I had already shaped. It was actually the back half. And it was actually one of the back halves you saw in one of my tutorials. It was the one that I screwed up. So I did a whole new back half and I did a whole new front half. That was the scrap one that I had. So I repurposed it, and I still have bits and pieces of it. But I repurposed it into the handle pieces, because I don't like waste. So you can see here that it's nice and flush. You can also see that there's a little bit of hot glue mess here at some of the seams where it came through. You can also, you might be able to see that there is a little bit of space here because the foam itself is not entirely flat on the bottom. It has a textured surface on the bottom. And so you can see that there's jagged edges here that I'm probably going to have to fill in unless I can shave that all the way down. Because for some of this on the side, it will be shaved at a bevel because I want this to have a rounded shape all the way around. It's not just going to be flat. At least that's the image I have in my head. I can't promise it will actually turn out that way. Sometimes my ambitions are greater than my talent, which you can see there. There's my tag for the poplar, and there's all the rest of the splinters, which I actually don't have to shave those off because they're going to be covered in foam. So now I need to figure out which piece. I think it's... Nope, this end it is rounded, so it's not this one. I think it's this one. Like that. Which means that these two should go... Yep, these two go together. Like that. So that's for this one. So this one needs to go down here. And the markings on here I made from the handle itself. I figured out that I wanted 2 inches here, and then 1 inch each for the divots, and then the center portion is what's going to fit in my hand. So I basically made the markings on the back so I could flip it over and just kind of sketch the lines here so that I could tell where I need to shave the hardest. I'm going to have to shave all of it because the ends need to be rounded. They need to be smoothed off. But those are going to be my nice little divots. All right, so second one, and it looks like I'm running low on hot glue, so I pulled another stick just in case. Like so. All right, so let's start here at the back. You'll notice I'm doing this right about in halves. And I will rather carefully place this down. And then push, and again, I do apologize for my large head being in the way. And I'm noticing here that I actually cut the handles a little bit unevenly here at the top. This, the one underneath, is actually slightly longer than this one here on top. So I'm probably, you can see it there on the side, you can see that one is actually slightly longer than the other. So I'm probably going to have to take and try and shave down so that they both meet right there at the tip. You can see the foam is actually longer than the wood. I need to trim that down a little bit. So I may end up having to take my cutting wheel, which is this guy, and slicing through it. And hopefully, once I do that, not slicing through the wood as well. Because it took me a long time to cut this. I only have one poplar stick left. And frankly, I would rather not have to cut the knives again. I'm hoping that that spare poplar stick that I showed you guys will be used to redo my Umi Ryuzaki sword, actually. In much the same way that I'm doing these. Here we go. And push. I actually have until mid-October to finish this costume. So I have a little bit of time. However, as some of you may know, I'm also a symphony musician on the side. It's actually one of my part-time jobs. Part-time because we only do it for 8 months of the year, and then we have the summer off. But in October, we start symphony season again. And that means that I'm basically going to have to put down my cosplay for a time so that I can practice and get the music where it needs to be so that we can perform it. So with that, and because the week before Texas Renaissance Festival, I'm probably going to need it for packing and such. There we go. So now that's nice and glued. So since I'm going to be packing right before TRF, I won't really have that week to work on cosplay either. So more or less I have about a month to finish this. So now that I've glued this one down, it's nice and sturdy. Has a good feel to it. Still a little bit thick. I'm lucky because I actually have, you know, monstrous big hands that have catcher's mitts for palms. So I can wrap my hand around this really easily, and it feels pretty comfortable, but it still feels just slightly big. It's not quite as comfortable as just the raw stick. I like shinies. Probably a little too much. And also, for those who are interested in seeing fire poi, I will be spinning fire at Texas Renaissance Festival. As I do every year, I do actually need to start practicing again so that I'm in practice. Sadly, around most of Texas, there are burn bans in place, so I cannot actually practice with them lit, which makes me a little bit sad, but, you know, rules are rules. And because of that, I will end up having to practice with my LED poi. Which is perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with LED poi. Let's see, this end is rounded. So this one goes on back. This one goes on front. This way. Now I do practice with my fire poi during the year. I do not practice with them lit. I practice with them unlit. And that's mostly because of the weight. If you have never actually had a chance to touch fire poi, they are rather heavy. And the reason for that is because they are made of Kevlar. And Kevlar is, of course, used for police vests and all other manner of protective gear. It's also used for motorcycle gear, incidentally. But Kevlar is fire retardant. And thus, fire poi are made from taking strips or cords of Kevlar fabric. And they are wound in various patterns. For cathedral, they're wound accordion style, you know, they're folded back and forth. For monkey fist poi, which are little spheres, then they're wrapped in what's basically a Turk's head knot. And then you take that large mass of Kevlar and you dip it in lamp fuel because it's a little safer to burn. It burns at a lower temperature. And it's similar to alcohol in that it burns off. So you basically get about 3 to 5 minutes, depending on how soaked your poi get, of spinning action before it all burns off, and then you do what's called spinning off, or spinning out, which is, well, you spin until the fire dies. And once you do that, once you have spun out, well, then you go and you soak your poi again, and lather, rinse, repeat, until you have no more lamp fuel. Or until you get tired, because spinning those does take quite a bit of physical stamina. I fully admit that when I go to TRF, I am lucky if I get 3 burns before my arms just can't take it anymore. But 3 is usually enough, because there's usually other fire spinners there, so you can take breaks in between them. And there's also fire breathers. Although they use full-on alcohol, they don't use lamp oil most of the time, from what I have heard. If you can spit lamp oil, I have heard it is also disgusting. And those I do not speak from experience. I am not willing to drink lamp oil. And I know you don't drink it. I know you spit it back out. I know it doesn't actually go down your throat. I'm aware. But it just sounds gross. Here we go. I'm trying to make sure that these mostly match up. I know they don't exactly match up. And that's just due to my failure of skill with a scroll saw. It is difficult on scroll saws to cut in a straight line. A perfectly straight line, and the reason for that, if you have not used a scroll saw before, is because the saw blades have tension. In fact, you can flick them like a little rubber band and they have a pitch. If they are too tense, and you are cutting through a material that is tough, your saw blade is more likely to break off and, you know, fly as shards into your face and your eyes and all sorts of places. So you don't want to have the saw blade too tight. Well, if you have any sort of looseness in your saw blade, which is, you're supposed to have a little bit, if you have any of it, then when you try and cut a tough material that pushes back, then the saw blade will slide a little bit because it is flexing, and it's difficult to control that. And because of that flexing, it is actually difficult to cut in a straight line. I have a little bit easier time with foam just because it doesn't push back as hard as poplar does. And that's just due to the nature of the material. There we go. And so that will be the other blade handle. And I do not need the hot glue gun anymore, so I'm going to unplug it. Both for safety and for conserving electricity reasons. I'm going to take this away. There we go. And you guys will probably notice that there is faint sound in the background, and that does happen to be the Daily Show. And that's because I am a crafter that cannot work in silence. I actually do have to have some sort of white noise in the background. And that's just the nature of how I work. My mind needs to be slightly distracted for me actually to be the most productive. I know that doesn't seem very straightforward. Alright, so I've got my handle, and I'm just kind of eyeballing this in my head so I can figure out what it is I need to do with it. Because I know I need to carve, and you can see that the lines do match up for the most part on both sides. And that was good. That means I actually glued these together correctly, and it means I marked my lines correctly. Always a good thing, because, to be honest, I have never done this before. This is actually the first pair of wooden props I have ever made, and that is partially why I'm filming this, is so that you guys can see this and learn from my mistakes. And at the moment, I am actually putting on a dust mask, which you probably saw me just take from the table. And that is because I have found out that I am allergic to foam dust. And so if it gets on me, then I itch really, really, really badly. And inhaling it would probably not, you know, do wonders for my lungs. So I do wear a dust mask. And most of the time I do also wear goggles, and that's so the dust doesn't fly in my eyes either. Unfortunately, occasionally the dust mask does fog up. And I have not found a great way of preventing that yet. It's just due to breathing, normal breathing. So I'm going to put on the dust mask. Now, you probably won't hear me speak for the next few minutes simply because it'll be all muffled through the dust mask and, you know, this is kind of loud. But I'm going to do this in front of the camera. I'm going to start to carve the handle. So hopefully this will be a good learning experience, whether it's a mistake or not. This way you guys can see that, you know, this is a potential way of making your props. So dust mask going on now. There we go. I've already got my hair pulled back in a ponytail so that it's up and off my face, because it's about 96 degrees outside at the moment. Alright, so safety goggles are on. There we go. My mask is already starting to fog up a little bit. Yes, you can make jokes about me breathing too hard. Go right ahead. So when I carve into this, it's going to take a little bit of pressure and it's hard to control, so I'm going to try and do this little by little. So here we go. This is the reason I keep a dry paintbrush around. It's mostly so I can, you know, dust both myself off and the Dremel. Because you want to make sure that you keep dust out of the internal workings of it. It'll help it last longer. I know the bearings are sealed, but that doesn't always help. Unfortunately, my safety goggles fogged up so much I couldn't even see what I was doing, so sadly I'm going to have to discard those for a little bit. I'm going to try and brush this off so that you can see. I have a little bit of an end kind of hanging here, so I'm going to peel that off. So you can see the profile, like that. And see how it kind of carved a little channel in there. I wasn't very even. One side is a little more carved than the other. But, like I said, I want to take this little by little, since I'm not entirely sure how deep I want this yet. There. Alright. So, more or less, I'm going to turn off the cam for a little while, because this is going to get a little bit repetitive. And I'm going to carve out all 8 of these little ditches, and then see what I can do about cleaning up the edges. So I'll be right back once I've got the finished product. At least as far as the handles, and I'll show you what we got. So now you see the lovely foam dust mess that is my work area, because I did shave quite a bit of foam. My little paintbrush has gotten quite a bit of a workout. But I wanted to show you guys the preliminary sculpt here. You can see now that it definitely has a profile. There's a rounded part here in the middle, and this is where I grab it. And you can see that I've tried to round off the edges a little bit as well. It is uneven, and that's simply because that particular sanding drum that I'm using, I'll let you see it from the other side, that sanding drum that I'm using is very coarse, and so that's why I have all the lumps. I'm basically going to have to go back over it with a diamond grinding bit, which is a little bit more delicate, and basically take off all of the coarseness that you can see, you know, reflected here in the shadow and contrast. But, you know, for a first sculpt job, this is actually pretty good. I am okay with this. Granted, I'll have to, you know, round the edges a bit more here. But I made a pretty good guess about the size of my grip here, because my hand fits almost exactly right around that spot. The divots are a little bit deeper than I wanted, but I think I can smooth those out here, right on the slopes. But I think I can make it look good. So, I'm gonna finish off with this one, and then I'm gonna go ahead and tackle the other one, and we will see what happens. And apparently I have literally gotten dust on everything, including the tripod that this camera is sitting on. So if you hear me brushing, it's because I'm trying to get all of the foam dust off of everything, because I ended up doing a lot of shaving off of the handles. There we go. Of course, my hands are all kind of full of dust, too. So I'll have to vacuum this up later. But here are the finished handles. You see the profile there on the side is a little bit more flat and even. And there's a lot less of the coarse bumps that you saw earlier from before. There is still that very distinct center ridge for me to grab onto, but you can see it's a little bit more rounded at the handle itself, so that almost from head on it has actually a pretty decent profile, and likewise from the back, that it has a good profile. You really can't see, just looking head on, that there's a really distinct lump here where my hands sit. But these actually have a really good grip now. I mean, really good grip. I'm actually really pleased with it. And you can see that I did them both almost evenly. I'm pretty close. I mean, there's still a couple of places on both where it's not exactly as even with the other. But overall... Oops, I've still got a lot of dust there. But overall, they look pretty darn even. Like that. Good solid handles, you know, good feel. I'm really happy with this. So my next step with the handles now, I need to decide... Well, first I need to clean up all the dust, but I need to decide whether or not I want to plastidip the handles, which is rubber spray. Let me grab my plastidip real quick. This stuff. I can plastidip them, which will basically coat them in rubber, and make them nice and flexible. Nice even coating. Or I can go ahead and gesso over them. And then what is basically the equivalent of paper mache over them to give them a nice even finish. Technically, I suppose I could use Bondo as well. However, since I don't currently have Bondo, I don't necessarily want to buy a large container just to smooth over these handles, because more or less the only thing I really need to do with these is to give them an even finish. They're fairly smooth, and they'll be a little bit better once I get this, you know, the rest of the excess dust off, which I've been brushing them with the brush, but some of this is just being really stubborn, and it doesn't come off easily. So I'm probably going to need to give it a good finish. I did try going over it with the diamond bit, and unfortunately, it didn't do very much. So the diamond bit, unfortunately, isn't going to be what I need to use on these. But there you have it. You know, there's my nice shiny daggers. I will go ahead and on the show, you guys will see the final results once I've actually painted them and attached all the ornamentation and whatnot. So you guys will see the final results. It may not be next show. I'm not entirely sure, to be honest, because a lot of this is going to be weather dependent and supply dependent, because of course to spray paint, you need spray paint. Another alternative I could do, for those who don't have facilities to be able to spray paint or simply aren't of age, you can also get something called aluminum tape, and it's literally a roll of tape that is coated with aluminum, and it has adhesive on the bottom. And you can literally stick it along the blade in the shape of the blade. If you guys ended up watching the armor and prop making panel that I did with Wilco, she actually talked about it, and she had her Hylian shield that she did with her Link cosplay, where she actually used metallic tape. And I believe her Master Sword also used the same tape. And it looks fantastic. It's not cheap. The last time I went to Home Depot, I believe it was $11.72 a roll. And it's a pretty decent-sized roll. I want to say it's 2 inches wide, and it was 30 feet long. So that's a pretty decent size of tape. That'll last you a little while. So that's certainly another option. It will give you a mirror finish, so if you're looking for something a little more weathered, it's not very easy to weather the aluminum tape from what I have seen. So if you're looking for something like that, you may wish to do a more traditional finish and then use the regular rub and buff as you would for weathering armor and props. But other than that, if you guys have any questions about anything that I have done here, feel free to message either me personally or you can message the show. I am always happy to discuss what it is I'm doing, and I'm always happy to show my mistakes too. So if you have any sort of questions, or even if you have tips for me, please do let me know, because I'm always willing to learn from other people. Like I said, this is the first time I'm actually making wooden props using this particular method, so I'm still learning. But I did want to show you guys just so that you could see how this process works.